It's okay to be brief.
Yes.
Okay, so let's just, there's some history there on what's been done. Essentially, long story short, nothing has officially been funded, which I think everybody knows. And what has been, it hasn't officially been identified, Jody, correct, that we were going down the $20 tab.
We had an ordinance drafted in 2016, I believe, that made it almost to the public hearing process and then stalled. That ordinance probably did say something along the lines of the tab.
I'm gonna talk.
It's okay.
So essentially, there's the vehicle tab of $20, and if the city and council decides to go down that path, essentially within 24, it has to stay there within 24 months, and then it can be increased to $40. And again, after 24 months, it can be increased to $50. Also, there's a voter approval option, which is 22% of sales tax. And then you can also, if you want to start above $20, you can go to that further as well.
You want to start with the...
If you wanted do anything between $20 to $100 in the tab increase, then you have to go to the people. Which I will put a note in there that off of the MRSC website, they have basically said anything that has been put out to a vote through a tab fee, essentially the history is very high that they are voted down. The only one that has been successful has been the City of Seattle for $60, and but they had to run it twice.
And also there's the provision that you need something that increase after, was it your second year, 40?
Yeah, right. The 24 so, run, yes.
So
yeah.
Right now, maybe between 20 and 100, but if the council does the 20, they can go to 40, and if they want to go below 100 later, then that was...
If they wanted to say, just for an extreme example, take it out to be voted on and do the $100, then that would be absolutely good. That could be a choice to go about that, but we have to do it through the voter program. Yes. So essentially, we're basing this off of 2018 year-end estimates, 990,000 that's provided, and if you do the calculations, it does end up calculating $80. In the biennium, if it was a full, true 2-year calculation, it would be almost 400,000. However, it's the caveat there is that it could be a year before we even get it voted on, implemented, and there's cutoffs that you have to meet in order to report it to, you know, to get your funding. So there is definitely a lag time. And essentially, because the city of Duval is experiencing a definite increase in sales tax, I wanted to do a 5-year average just for a realistic on what we think that would be moving forward. So essentially, we just based it off of I did a 5-year average to give us possibly, take us the best case scenario to possibly a 5-year a reality. Had an assistant doing it for me. So essentially, we went back and found all of the 2014 documents that were brought forward from, I believe it was Public Works. And so we thought that this was actually pretty interesting, that the vehicles, and we are, I guess, making an assumption that we're guessing that they came from Department of Licensing also, because that's where we received our 2018 number. With the $20 tab fee, Department of Licensing does have a 1% fee for administering it, and so those are the numbers essentially. And then basically, so for, was it for 2019, I think the DOL suggested about, I think, 6 months after you say you're going to start, before they will start collecting, so that's why you see only the half for 2019.
There's a lag.
So there's that lag shown here.
And within also, thank you, within through further research, they say that the Department of Licensing, essentially the number that they give you, that it's probably a better estimate to only plan for 80% of the number they provide on your the registered vehicles within your area code or your zone for your city. That that's more of a true number than what you end up receiving, or what the dollars that you end up receiving from the designated vehicles.
And so 80% of this is likely?
That's, and so I wanted to also show that with, and that's just information from people that have experienced it from the past, that have had previous TDDs, that have done it through the tabs.
So this is the, these are the numbers from Department of Licensing.
The 6673 is from Department of Licensing.
Correct. And then 80% is, that's what we were as a, essentially a best case scenario.
Oh,
to,
not over budget, overestimate
your revenue. It's 80% seems to be a truer outcome.
No, I got you. I was focused over this column that didn't look over here. So, got it now.
So that could be 80% of the 159.
Yes, 80%. No, so we took the tabs. That's why it's reduced from the 6,673 down to the 5,338.
Okay, you reduced the cars.
Reduced the
number.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Got it.
I'm much more of a morning person than a night person. Sorry.
You all had pizza too. So.
Sorry.
And then this is also not accounting for any additional vehicles in Tupelo. So we're still assuming 2018 vehicle totals for 2019 and 2020, because there's just, we don't have the ability to project out what that increase would be, or decrease for that matter.
So it's very similar. Can you back up to the last one? No, 163. So is that 163?
So that's a biennium versus an annual.
An annual. Okay, but then there would be a lag in this. And we're just thinking of what happens 2 years from now. Because there's a lag in this, but there's a lag in the other two. And you could probably generate a similar amount of money either way, it seems like.
Yeah, so part of what on this final is sort of trying to kind of compare what it could be. With sales tax, it's going to be more closely tied to how the economy is doing. You don't always see people drastically reducing the number of cars they have in downturns, but they're going to cut the amount of, they may not buy a new car, but they will cut down the what they go out and purchase. So this was just sort of to try to encompass the different pros and cons of each, just out of some general things to note about both options.
Right. And it's also construction.
Right.
We're
right.
doing a lot of building construction right now, which there's a good amount of sales tax.
Right.
That will
yes.
go away too, depending on things. But we're going through a lot of it.
And that's why I went back and did the 5-year average to just, if we are, if there is definitely a portion within that of, and I know that's been an ask of identifying one-time revenue out of sales tax, trying to get us to a truer average of what we possibly can expect on.
So even if sales tax is half of what it is now, it would be about the same as the 20-other tab.
Yeah, so.
And that is, the tab is Duval residents paying for streets used by everyone, whereas the sales taxes, everyone that comes to Duval pays for the roads that they use to get here.
That's interesting, because staff, people told me for years that the sales tax option didn't generate as much money. But they didn't ever tell me what the number was.
Let's stay focused on.
And what's interesting is within past presentation, the sheet that in 2014, it essentially identified both within a presentation in 2014, and it did have the higher sales tax. And if you want a copy of that.
Yeah, let's just focus on where we're at now. I think that's the most important thing. What's best case scenario? We got something on the ballot. We got it passed. What would be the day that we would collect money for this?
So I think that depends on which election we can make it on. I think technically the February election has a December 15th cutoff for materials, which would mean that we would have to have everything ready to go right around the time that you're passing budget, right? Or a little after, which is very tight to produce all the materials needed to have it vetted. And
yeah, you have to do the pro-con statements. You have to do your resolutions to put it on the ballot, not to mention that it's a very expensive election to be a part of.
Probably looking at the general election. Minimum $11,000.
Well, we're talking the revenue differences on the scale of hundreds of thousands of dollars.
In the long term, yes.
In the long term, yeah.
What is our standard compared to other smaller states to do?
We must be here to claim. We have a very low sales tax base.
Plus, the actual percent.
Per capita?
It's lower than most cities in the region. It's
8.6 sales tax, if that's what you're asking.
Total. Because some of them are 9.
If you're part of the, what is that, the ARTS?
Sound Transit, or whatever. Sound Transit District, most people are over 10.
So I think the point is, if we do the sales tax increases at 0.2, we're still lower than sales tax than most anyone else. Mm-hmm.
It would be the
point. It's two sales tax.
But I also want to let you guys know that if we take it out to a vote, I'm guessing, Jody, a $20,000 cost.
It depends on what election you go with. If you go with the spring election, you're looking at a minimum of $11,000. And then if you go with the general, you're looking at a just shy of $7,000 investment. And you're going
to
get
4 to 7 something, but that's assuming everyone goes out for it and explains the cost. And
if it's already the time of year that we're having a council or mayor election, isn't there an economy of like when we add something when we already have other things on?
The elections for the seats are not run by the city necessarily. I mean, we don't. That's not us putting something on the ballot necessarily, because we're not the ones who are putting your ballot stuff out there. The individuals are. But if we, like two years ago, we did the advisory vote on the fireworks, and then we added the
SRO, IT levy, and then added
the advisory vote, and really all it did was add $250 to our cost for the voter pamphlet.
Do we know for sure? Because I wonder if the cost is somewhat related to making sure all of those cities have this specific ballot that has certain things. And so if we already have a Duval specific ballot,
if we do not put something on the election, we pay zero election costs. This has nothing to do with your voter registration fees, which we pay no matter what, and it's a separate line in your budget. Election costs alone, if you have zero things on your ballot, you have $0 coming out of your pocket.
So on the years that we have council and mayor on the ballot, we pay zero?
Yeah, I believe so, because we're not the ones putting that on the ballot. The city of Duval doesn't.
It's the King County elections.
You as a candidate are putting something on the ballot.
We pay.
Right, so.
So the city doesn't have to pay any, so I guess I just was seeing that there were election costs in the past in certain years, and so, and we didn't typically put things on the ballot. And so I just assumed it was maybe.
And election costs are kind of funny too, because it's one of those ones where you should end up paying, especially if you're in a general election, you pay after the year ends, so somebody.
So I think we should stay focused on, because I think it comes down to a question of timing and what we can do. We would also need, for a successful ballot, you would need a really, you know, a really well-developed list of projects, and you probably would have bought the public and say, this is what it is, and that maybe that time's not there in the short term. But, because I think at the end of the day, the election costs will be, if you're looking at the revenue differences for streets, and it's a long-term plan, I mean, that would be, your preparation and timing would be kind of one and two, and the cost of elections, if it's under a certain amount, would be minimal in the grand scheme of things. So, I don't know where we're at, but in terms of, I think it's an important point to take home, the differences in revenues. And apparently, people don't like car tab fees. I mean, if they tell you that they go out, people really don't like them. But not to say that we need to figure out a way to fund streets. Yes?
I was just going to say, and thank you for letting me take a minute. We'll put the $20 on there and get the conversation started and see if we can start getting the funds in the account. So I am thrilled that council is talking about options that actually more fully fund the plan. But I also want to make sure council knows that because we have a transportation benefit district, your next meeting to discuss that will need to get on the calendar as a transportation benefit district before the council meeting. And the city council serves as a transportation benefit district.
Well, we serve that now.
What's that?
We service that now.
Yeah. Correct, but you still have to notice the meeting of the transportation benefit district. You have to hold a separate meeting. It's a separate board, even though it's the same people.
You
can check on that.
I think we want to just do whatever we could to make sure we're above boards on it. I think it comes down to timelines, maybe. Yeah.
So if we put the sales tax on there, there's no, it could fail. So, I mean, the $20 tap, that we wouldn't have, that would not have to go to vote, right?
Correct.
We just didn't. So.
We could.
Oh, I was just going to say, if the sales tax failed, that means that the $20 tab is really going to make people unhappy. That's a sign. And so for me, I would rather understand what, and the other, I guess one other really quick thing is, if you compare how much it would cost a household for the car tab, like I just put my family in, let's say I have three vehicles, the car tab's going to cost me $60 a year. Now, worst case scenario, how much do I spend in Duval? You know, $500 a month is really kind of a high estimate, because that would be taxable money I spend in Duval. I mean, normally I'm buying prescriptions, groceries, getting my hair cut. Those are all things that aren't taxed, okay? So let's say this really high number of I spend $500 a month in Duval buying dog food or going to the out to eat. Okay, it would only cost me $12 in an entire year in TBD sales tax. So I think if the community understood, this is allowing the cost to be shared by people who use our roads and not just homeowners in Duval. And so, you know, you think of, yes, sales tax can be somewhat volatile, but why is it volatile? Partly it would be volatile as it goes up when we have construction. Well, when construction is happening, all those construction vehicles are beating our roads up, right? They're clipping the corners and wrecking the curves, and so you would get extra revenue in those years. And I really think of the streets fund is a long-term investment, and it doesn't mean your revenue has to be perfectly even every year. You can do more projects when you have more money. You do less projects, you know, in other years. And the other point I want to make is population. Just look at the last 8 years. Population has grown about 18%. So your tabs will only grow as quickly as your population grows. But if you look at sales tax revenue over the last 8 years, it's grown 75%. So, you know, in general, I would say population is growing, you know, about 1 to 2%, maybe, you know, in high years it can be more. But sales tax, historically, over time, is probably going to keep up with inflation more likely as our economy grows, as we're investing in more businesses. I just think it's a more fair way to pay for our streets, and in the end, it would cost individual residents much less money, personally. And my calculations show that based on that amount of sales tax, it would actually generate closer to about $240,000 annual revenue. And your question about, you know, what other cities earn. So for example, North Bend is a similar size city. They earn about twice as much sales tax. And their TV generates about $500,000. So they make about twice as much. And the rate that the city gets on their crime right now is about the same. You know, you asked how much each city's sales tax is. A city can't just raise their sales tax. There's very specific parameters of you can have one for the TV and different things like that. So that those are my points. I feel like if the community is behind this, they'll vote yes. If they're not behind it, forcing a $20 tab on them, I just don't think it generates enough revenue to make everyone angry. And I honestly wouldn't support it because I don't think it's fair to make residents pay for the roads that everyone's using. So.
There's a couple more questions on the going out the vote. Is it simply a majority vote? Do we know?
That I don't know.
Because
I think it is.
It's just simple. So it's not based off of you know, the last election, you know, if you had a presidential election, or this one's generating a lot of interest. So is it based off a percent of the last election? In other words, my fear is that if we have, you know, a lot of places get, you know, 50-55% of the residents, so they didn't have enough voters.
Mm-hmm. So all the majority referendum.
Yeah, so I'm just.
It's not a problem.
I think we need to look into those details, but I certainly agree with you know, for the sales tax. Seems like it meets the need, and I'd much rather be talking to our citizens about why we would do a 0.2% increase on the sales tax than $20. That's just citizens just say we voted to say get rid of all that extra stuff on our car tabs, and every time the government entity adds something, they go, didn't he hear us? You know, I worry about that as well.
Yeah. I think I definitely want to go for the sales tax. I mean, I've had many people talk to me and ask, why don't we raise our sales tax? It's so low compared to other places. And I agree with, you know, what's been said. I think it's fair. I think it makes sense. We're asking everyone who comes in and buys things in town to contribute. And I think it'd be a lot easier for the community to swallow. But we'll see. I mean, I would leave it to them.
Yeah, I appreciate getting the information. But one concern I have about $20 tab, not only the psychology of it, which I think is so great, it really just doesn't generate enough revenue to do a whole lot in a city our size. And I think if we look at our, because I think what a referendum will do will require all of you to figure out as part of a ordinance for this ballot measure what projects this money would go to. And specifically nail down what outcomes that money would be allocated to. And then voters would say, how's that coming along? You know, there's some accountability there. Whereas if we just do another, like all these things like coffee taxes, where it costs as much as a couple of cups of coffee, you know, generates some revenue. Not a whole lot to do anything. Council never really thinks it's that much money, so it's not hurting anyone, or that they don't even care. But nothing really happens with those types of revenue increases from what I've seen. But if there's something that can be done that creates action and creates accountability, I just think government works a lot better. Our community would work a lot better. And there's also other revenue options, and how to ask the city about potential grading permit fee or some other type of permit fee maybe we could do in the interim. Now that we have construction, roads getting torn up, that we could create a different revenue source that doesn't impact our community, but comes from those damaging our roads, that that we could also start to fund our streets program with. And then lastly, I think it would be good, I'll forward you a link to it, but to read at the actual legislation of the Transportation Benefit District and what provisions that allows council acting as the TPD board to do. Because it gives you a lot of authority. Because basically you act as a utility authority or utility board. And it's a lot different than most other legislative things you'd be involved in. So it gives you the ability to administer. That's it.
Streamline taxing, so do you get sales from the liquor and Amazon and stuff like that? It's obvious to me that the sales tax is a good way of making more money off of folks, so people purchase things, they buy things, and then they don't quite see it, because they don't really notice that 4%. And psychologically, I can tell by the numbers too that it's just going to bring in more revenue. My only concern is to make sure that it's, once again, it's coming to your general fund, it's earmarked. Mm-hmm. How do we keep track of exactly that 2% that comes in has to go to the street maintenance? Because my problem is, or why I like the tabs, was that, you pay that 20, it goes exactly to what we said it's going to go to. You pay 2% more in taxes, we can't guarantee exactly,
So my understanding from other cities, other finance directors that I've talked to, is that essentially when we receive that, it's identified as a completely separate line item. So it's very transparent on how, that's my understanding. So it doesn't just get wrapped into and then broken out on a calculation that's done internally, which would be, just honestly probably more open to error. I think it's done on the back end for you and provided on your state share of revenues essentially as a separate line.
Yeah, so then I think that it's close in the long term, really, you'll probably be getting, the citizen will be putting more money into the $20, really, with 2%. So that would be collecting more from them anyway, which that's to what we need to program. It's just any fee for anything.
I don't know how many vehicles you have in your household and how much you spend a month even.
We're very austere.
I think the point two you would have to spend to get, if you have two cars, you would have to spend, which would be $40 a year total, you'd have to spend $20,000 in Duval or have something mailed to Duval, $20,000 a year of taxable items. You'd have to spend a lot of money that's taxable within City of Duval, because when you buy items at Costco in Woodinville or any of those other places, it doesn't affect how much you pay in taxes. It's only things that you buy in Duval or have shipped to your house that are taxable. Anyway.
No, I'm fine.
Yeah.
I have a list of things I think we'd like to follow up with, but I think, for whatever reason, I kind of have a similar feeling you do. For some reason, people have such an aversion to taxes, so it seems as though that's much more of a clear path for us. So it seems as though what we're looking for going forward is to confirm the percentage of the vote and possibly a timeline for both the sooner and then a later election cycle. if we could possibly do that, but then also including in that timeline, if it's part, like what it would take to do the list, if it's even feasible to come up with that list. So just, and obviously not as a high level exercise.
I think as a TBD, you're going to create that list. You're going to create that list. We're going to give you what your options are, and then you're going to prioritize them and decide what you want.
Yeah, but basically though, just in terms of theoretical timelines that we could take from here to the next step, saying, yeah, this is what we want to do. Like, we think it's reasonable to shoot for the sooner timeline or the later timeline.
I think you're looking at November of next year, realistically, to put your story together and to go out to the community and have at least one, if not two, town hall meetings. Because if you want it to pass, you're going to have to work. There'll be the proverbial ways, and now it's going to be a really heavy lift. Taxes are hard.
And the other piece of that is that it allows for up to the 0.2. So some communities are choosing to come in at the 0.1 instead. So that is another option, is you don't have to go for the full 0.2 right off the bat.
And you could also think about any other ballot measures you might want to run, since it's cheap to run two together.
So we entered this conversation a few years ago because we were presented with the plan of what it would take to maintain our roads. And as I recall back then, it was smart and wise to continue to do the maintenance incrementally now, because if we don't do anything about it and we let it lag, what we have to pay to fix the roads would be, forget the $20 car tap fee, it would be so expensive. So that's why we even entered into this kind of a discussion. So my thing is, if we're going to put it to the vote, and if they say no, I would just like to make sure we have a plan B, so we don't sit there with zero and no plan, and that we're offsetting and doing a bad thing for the community by doing that. So we have a plan B if the voters say no, we don't want the 1% or 2% increase in sales tax.
Option for you. This is not an option I support, but what you could do is you could adopt the $20 tap fee automatically, and you could agree to rescind that if the public approves the tax instead.
Good idea.
I wouldn't. I would support it, but it's not cheap.
I just think it's really just unwise for us to defer. The folks out there don't understand what we're going to put on their shoulders by having inaction and not doing anything about it. And I don't think they would appreciate it. So that's what we have been elected to do, is to make those hard decisions. You know, either way we go, no one's going to like us. So I think we have to let people know, though. It's only fair to let them know. Do you want to not pay anything today, or do you want to have us raise your utilities down the road and do things that you'll be really screaming at us for because we didn't do something now? That's the part that bothers me, is that it's now, 3 years since I've had this discussion, and we're still at Groundhog Day. We're still here. And it just doesn't feel right to me, because it's a responsibility, and I can't see, it's like the back of Safeway when you drive down that road. And I don't know how long it took to get to that way, but I remember driving when it wasn't like that, and it's, that was 10 years. And if we don't do something and start appropriating the money and being responsible, we're going to look at our roads starting to fall apart, just like King County, where you're dodging those giant, potholes and wondering what's going on, patch and phrase not working anymore. So either way, whatever we do, no one's going to be happy with this, but I do want to know if they vote it down, that we have an option. I'm not afraid to say $20 to save the roads and not putting some crazy utility fee out down the road because we didn't take care of business.
Yeah, I'm with you in terms of, I'd be ready to do a $20 tap fee, but I think in general, it's, I think in terms of the long-term solution, I think getting a couple more couple more bits of information so we can kind of take that next step to saying this is where we want to move forward. Because I think there's still a couple of things, you know, in terms of timing and the vote and the percentage of vote, just verifying that. But it seems otherwise, we're all the same page. Yes.
Just about. I think what's hard for me is $20 car tab fee is not going to be enough to really do much at all. And so very soon you'd be forced with raising it to $40 a car, because $100,000 or I forget what you said, per year on the car tab. So $122,000 a year on average, is that right?
Yeah, the
5-year average. So, I'm just, and I know it came up at the meeting before that it cost $50,000 to repair that very small section of road. And that was on my street, 147th Court. There was a water main break. It is the road that fronts 1.5 houses. Very small section of road. Cost $50,000 to repair. So do we really, you know, so we can do a tiny section of road every year? I mean, I just think, I just can't imagine having every single, you know, I have three cars, three times a year I'm going to fill out my thing and see that $20 car tab and, or $40 car tab to actually do anything meaningful for the city, and the projects I'm seeing come out of it are a 100-foot section of road, or, you know, I would have a hard time justifying that, because if we really wrote a list of projects and then compared it to how much we're making, we will very, very, very slowly start ticking items off of that list. And it would be very discouraging for the community to say, to see how very little we can do with $120,000 a year. That's, I think, my painful.
Yeah, let's just start going around one more time here, and then close it up, I think. Councilmember Hogue, you're next.
Going into this, I've been in favor of the car tabs, mostly because time, right? If we have to put the sales tax on the ballot in November of next year, is that right? Is that a year from
It's about a year from now.
We might even start seeing the money for
the August, but we have to go back.
Chances are it probably won't pass the first time, and it'll go another, you know, 6 months to a year. I just don't know that. I struggle with that one, really, because if we need the money now, the only way to do it is to leave the $20 car tab. I have five vehicles, so that would be expensive. So that's $100 a year. So I don't, I mean, I feel for the community, but if we need to be spending money on roads, what other options do they have?
Was there something specific that you were wanting,
no,
or
just
any? I mean, that's pretty much everything I said. I'd like to go for that first, and I'll put as much work into it as we, you know, talk to as many people as we can and try to, you know, get the right message, and then go from there if that doesn't work. But I get where you guys are coming out wanting a backup plan too. I understand that.
What's the cost difference, do we know, between running the ballot measure in the spring versus the general?
Spring is about $11,000, and general is about $6,500 to $7,000.
Okay, so I think we did the general election last time, and I remember it was around $6,500 to $7,000, plus we did a 2-for-1 special.
Right.
So we got bang for the buck.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing. If you think immediacy is the key thing, like I say, if you think people would vote for it, if you do a good job with a list and the ordinance, and then turn that over to you know, the other committee that we represented, or you could serve on the committee that represents it, but you just can't use any city resources to do that. I mean, you could promote the ballot measure, but not use any city resources. And still be involved. I would say that could be an option too. If immediacy is the key in trying to get it done earlier, it's, you know, $6,000 difference just to get it on the ballot sooner than later.
Okay.
Can I
from a staff perspective, I think I need to ask a couple of questions because we have a limited amount of time to continue to amend our budgets. So what I'm going to ask you to be thinking about is there's a general fund that supports our roads fund. And so if we're going to go towards the sales tax, then I think that we have to take out the TBD, which then unbalances our roads fund and our general fund, and we'll have to make decisions on where to cut in the general fund. And I can't remember how much money it was, but I want to say it was close to a couple $100,000. So I need you to be thinking about that, because I don't think we should be planning on the dollars, because if we get the tax, I think the soonest you'll see it is, if you're lucky, in the middle of 2020.
If I can add, we already had a request that were very all reasonable. We need things that staff needed. We already cut over $800,000 out of the general fund budget just to make it balance for what you have in front of you. So finding another $200,000, could you do it? Probably, but it would be very, very challenging. You guys get to make that decision, but it's an option, but that's what we would need to do.
So how does $160,000 result in $200,000?
Because we put in the existing budget that we have the $198,125 accounting for the 6 month and then the 2020's full year on the car tab estimation. But if you look back at your general fund, it's essentially supporting the street fund, and I believe it's $114,500. That's where we're talking. So if we take the revenue of the $198,000 out, we're then going to have to increase the amount that the general fund is supporting the street fund.
But I think to Councilmember Nikki's point, these funds would be earmarked for like overlays. And if you don't have the money, you don't do the overlays. That's pretty straightforward. I don't think it should be really used for funding any staff positions.
It can't.
Yeah, so it seems like you just don't do the overlays you were planning on doing. I mean, that's essentially what we were talking about earlier. I mean, it's the, that's a pretty straightforward, the projects just don't happen until later when we budget, when we put it to a vote and then get funding at that time.
Maybe you can walk us through it a bit slowly, because I get there's some tie. So maybe walk us through that.
Absolutely. So through the budget that's being proposed, if you go look on the line item for the street fund, so fund 101, you're going to see that there's a new line item created for TBD licensing, and that is funded at, there's no history, and it's funded at $198,125. And that is being allocated to overlays, a grant match, I think is $43,000 of it, and then the rest of that is split between, I think it's road reconstruction and overlay at a percentage that was derived from public works. So it's just to be very clear, that is not going to fund salaries in any way, shape, or form. That those dollars, the TBD dollars, let's just call them that. However, within your general fund, in order to get the street fund to balance without that $198,000, it had to support it at the tune of, I believe it's, can you double check that? $114,500, just because I don't want to give you an incorrect number.
So we're using the TBD funds for grant match and other sort of programs, CIP projects that were selected as part of the budget.
Correct.
the Baton Road project, and then again, this, I can't exactly remember, it was like a 60-40 split of reconstruction and then overlay from those dollars. But in 2017, I do know that the general fund supported the street fund at the tune of $94,000. And that was in the adopted budget. And now this year, in the biennium, we're increasing that support. So that's how it ties to the general.
So those specific projects are delayed?
Well, the grants, we'd have to see what that means in terms of that.
The grant match is essentially $43,000.
And that makes sense. I mean, up till now, as I see it, as projects happening or not happening. And if they don't happen, they don't cost any money. But if there's a grant, I mean, that's specifically a $43,000 grant match. What project is that? What's the timeline on the grant?
It's a project that we have technically been offered the grant for, but it's pending the road classification, and it's a project that would get done next summer. And then we try to keep about $40,000 in for other grant matches for projects that come up through TIB as well. So I'm just trying to let us get prepared for how we're going to figure out to do that.
I think this is, and I don't at all mean this to be taken as any more way than a constructive way. This is why we should visit some of these issues in June and have a retreat and we talk about this issue. So we didn't have to have it now. I'm sorry that it's happening now, but it is. So it would appear that council supports the sales tax increase over the TAB increase. So, and that's just, and that would be seemingly reflecting the will of the people they represent. So it might be difficult to timing, the situation might be difficult. I mean, I apologize.
I just wanted to say, if you look at the budget, asphalt overlay and roadway reconstruction, which we've spent basically zero money on the last 3 years, the current budget has $155 in it. So those would be items that we hadn't been able to fund, but now the TBD money is funding in the new budget. So those are items that are not grant related. There's a grant line item for the Baton Road reconstruction, but these are line items that hadn't been funded before that are now being funded. So those seem like directly related to TBD funding. So if we don't have TBD funding, those would be items that we maybe wouldn't do, and we haven't done in the last 3 years. We haven't had any expenditures. There's also more money in street cleaning than we've had in prior years. So it's not my job to figure out, you know, I guess what we may or may not cut to make it balance again. And I think Matt had a good point that, a discussion earlier talking about kind of these options would have been probably helpful.
So just to say one more time, I guess to frame it, I own a home. I put a lot of money, more than my car tax would be, every year. If I see any hint of a problem, I am on it. I would never defer it. It's an investment. And I'm looking at our streets the same way when we were presented with that plan, unless they were not being honest with us. I don't want to spend up to $1 million to do a replacement on something when we could have done it for $100,000 had we maintained it properly. And that is my biggest concern right now. And you're right, it's been years that's been a zero budget and we've done nothing. And so while we sit here and keep discussing this, you know, yes, people have shown up and gotten angry about $20, and I'm like, well, you'll be more upset with me when down the road we have giant potholes and we have to really charge you a lot of money to fix that road. And I think because that presentation hasn't come into the discussion, but, you know, that's the question, really, that's the question. Do we start fixing and maintaining properly what we have, our assets, Or do we just keep deferring, deferring till we have to do a major scrub of that whole street and pay, you know how expensive those roads are. I'd prefer us to just, my citizens can be angry with me and we do a wise work here and save them. It's going to save money to fix the roads now, to maintain them properly now. And that's my biggest concern right now. No, it would be very popular.
So you prefer to go with the tax, yeah?
I say if this sales tax fails, we should definitely really think about those tabs because that to put it off 2 more years and do nothing. I mean,
I think it seems that there's a strong consensus that we're good to go. We want to know more. We want to not just know more about it. We seem to be a large portion of us on the same page about the sales tax option.
For the tabs as well.
Well, let's go around. Councilmember Remington, would you prefer the tabs or the fee? And we need short answers so we can get through the
sales tax.
Okay, Jennifer?
Sales tax.
Tabs.
Tabs?
Sales tax.
And for sales tax, I would like to know two things. I probably can't be answered here tonight. This is just for reporting back, so it would be helpful for me. One would be the grants, and can we delay our proportionate share of those? Because the TBD grant has been awarded for that, correct? Right, okay. So can we delay that, and what's the repercussion of that? And then just some basic rudimentary, the Dan's point was a good point, what is the pavement condition? Is there anything awful about waiting another
I'm for the sales tax.
I'm for the tax. Pretty upfront, pretty straightforward.
Okay. So there we are. I mean, I think in the direction that we're looking right now is that we're looking at the sales tax and move forward. It's not perfect that it's another 6 to 8 months of wait time from the beginning of the year, but I think that's. So we got it. So if we lose a grant, or a potential lose a grant, I would take that into consideration. Okay. So maybe if we can look at the timelines, a basic timeline, what that would look like. I mean, I don't know. I'm not sure what's next. That's what, yes.
I also want to end on a note that when entities implement, whether it be a sales tax, whether it be tabs, that this money allows grant matches, which this city has an incredible history of getting grants for so essentially for $43,000, you're looking at that Baton Road reconstruction at $428,000. So these dollars, though they might not seem huge, if we can leverage them as grant dollars and matches, we can end up getting a lot more work done. So it's, I just want to leave you with that notion to tuck away.
Well, that's fine. I think my sense is if we went for sales tax and didn't get it, we'd do the correct thing. But is there a way to talk to voters and say, look, we're trying to fund our roads? And I'd love to try budget-wise to do this sooner than later. I realize realistically, mentioned a year from now, and that's probably more realistic. But most folks that are voting on something don't spend a year or 6 months trying to listen to it all. They listen to 2 weeks before they vote, and then they vote. And so I think that there's an opportunity. I'd love to see us, if it's possible, being cheap as early as spring. But here's what's on my mind. If citizens know that we're trying to fund this transportation benefit district, and that there's two options on the table, and tell them that, we have the power as council to do car tabs, and that's our plan, but we prefer the voters approve the sales tax. We can explain the why, other people outside help pay for it. It's a small amount. I'd love to hear those numbers. I think most citizens would say, wow, this actually costs money out of my pocket. And other people help fund it. But if we can word it in a way so that they realize, hey, we have these two options. If it failed, the sales tax, and we just put the car tax. And the citizens get a bit of a vote on it. I mean, you know, if they know the car tabs are coming, but they can eliminate that and go with the other, then most educated citizens would say, I'll approve it. So it gives them the choice, but a little bit of leverage to encourage them to vote for the sales tax.
I would support the sales tax, or the tab tax, the tab fee, if the sales tax does not go through. All right. Any other last thoughts before we go? I appreciate everybody's hard work and kind of flesh for tonight. Thank you.